Love, live, life. Life can be glorious and hideous. Stick your feet to the ground. Don't think you are counted out. Don't let the wind pull you and tear you apart. Let yourself live freely and love, and you'll be happy. No limits. Just keep on.
Hey guys, and welcome back to another Iron Will podcast with me, Shane Warner, and
John Chase.
So what this podcast is all about is we are trying to get stories from people that have been through a traumatic experience in their lives and came out a different person.
Yeah, they have all created an iron will. So what is an iron will? A burning determination that cannot be stopped or hindered by anything. Willing to do anything to get a desired outcome. Extremely resilient. So what we like to say is just keep punching.
Yeah. So sit back and relax, and we're going to start the show. And today we have Billy Weatherall on the podcast with us. And how I know Billy is from Heath White. Heath actually did a 100-mile walk with his daughter, Pepper, for Christ Fit Gym. And the funny thing is Billy is actually doing that event right now as we speak. Yeah. Anyway, I'm just going to have Billy kind of introduce himself and tell you guys what he's all about.
All right. Well, thank you. It's an honor and a privilege to be on the show. And my name is Billy Weatherall. I was in the Army 2000-2006, served with the 10th Mountain Division, 431 Infantry. I was deployed quite a few times in my six-year enlistment, went to Afghanistan for Operation Anaconda, did a tour in Africa, the Horn of Africa, and then I did Operation Iraqi Freedom. So did that, got out in 2006, and man, God got a hold of me shortly after my military stint. And I made a deal with God. I said, God, man, if you just save me, if you just give me my life, I said, I'll give you everything I got. Just give me something worth living for. Mm-hmm. Got back in the reserves, became a drill sergeant, started working oil and gas and got very successful in oil and gas.
Yeah.
In 2010, 2011, God called me to full-time ministry. And that's what I do now with Christ Fit Gym.
That's wow. Awesome.
Dude, that's great.
Can you talk a little bit more about your Army career?
Yeah. So ever since I was young, man, I come from a rich heritage and family of guys serving. You know, my dad was in the Marine Corps. My grandpas were pilots and chiefs in the Air Force. Man, everybody served. So when I was younger, there was no doubt about it. I was going to serve in the military. Mm-hmm. And barely graduated high school in 2000. just kind of a little rebel in high school.
Yeah.
Me too. And that was the same time period, 2000, man. That yeah. Year was a hard year, man. I actually got kicked out, but okay, keep going.
Yeah, and I was well on my way, and I remember telling the principal at school, I'm like, sir, if you just graduate me, I'm in the late entry program. Yeah. And I showed him my paperwork. I'm like, I'm going in the military. He said, you got to come to school, Bill.
Yeah.
So, yep.
I was raised by my grandparents, and I would just work all the time in high school. They were more concerned about me working and paying my bills than school. They never sent my report card, so I would work till, you know, midnight, 1 a.m., and that's why I miss school a lot. I joined the Army in 2000 and, you know, went to Fort Benning, went to airborne school, went to javelin school. Like, I just started doing all these high-speed classes after basic training, and I got to Fort Drum probably.
And this was before September 11th, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, got to New York, October, November of 2000, and then September 11th happened shortly after that, and man, just our world got rocked. Do you want me to share a little bit about that?
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Please.
Okay. So, joined 10th Mountain, and man, I'm 20 years old, and September 11th happens, and we're packing our A bags and our B bags, and we're one of the first units to get deployed. Mm-hmm. So it was a small unit.
Can I ask you how long your workup was?
It was not long at all. Okay. I mean, we were in September 11th happened, 2001. We are celebrating Christmas in Uzbekistan.
Yeah. Wow.
Of that year. So, I mean, we had our bags packed.
Yep.
went to Dover Air Force Base. And
let's go. No experience or anything. Just
I mean, basic training. That's it.
Yeah.
Wow.
20 years old. And so I go to Afghanistan. We get on a plane. Well, actually, we go to Dover, and we are on the plane. And my unit was kind of small, but it got packed full of Patriots. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, guys, you know, had just gotten out of basic training, but just joined because of September 11th. So September, October, November, we're getting guys straight out of basic training, but they're professionals. You know what I'm saying? These are college people,
right?
You know, in their 20s and 30s that joined right after September 11th because they wanted to do something great for our nation. They wanted to defend the nation. So my unit gets packed. We go overseas. We go to Dover. They hold up a picture of Bin Laden. And
this
they're saying,
"Who you're after?"
Yeah, this is who we're after.
Mm-hmm. That's
I'm like, never even heard of Afghanistan. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Never.
20 years old. They give me some purple gloves. They're like, "Hey, look, when you're on the battlefield, you're going to be swiping blood samples."
Did you have to have mop gear and stuff like that?
We took our mask, but we didn't take like mop level 4 stuff. Okay. But we were just too much. So
yeah.
We get there, and they're like, "Hey, we're going to do this Operation Anaconda. It's us, it's SF, it's some Ranger guys. We're going to destroy this compound in the Shaikat Valley." So we're like, "Okay, cool." We weren't really looking towards any resistance. But what we didn't know is we fly out on Chinooks, and the door gunner starts shooting as soon as, you know, we land, or as soon as we're going over the valley. 20 years on, I'm like, "Oh, my gosh, I can't believe it. Like, I'm in actual battle." Yeah. You know, the things that my grandpa talked about. So,
I'm can't even imagine how intense that was for a young kid. Like, we've never been, or in your lifetime, we've never been to war. So,
and, you know, and the first time that happened, I remember my hands were just shaking so bad. My adrenaline's pumping. I got an adrenaline pump. And, you know, it's just unlike anything I've ever experienced.
Yeah, for sure.
At that time in my life. And we get dropped off for Operation Anaconda. The enemy has dug in. They wrote a bunch about it. They're saying suspected enemy was 2,000. So once we landed, I mean, it just hit the fan. Mm-hmm. So I'm on my clue. So I'm a young kid. And I always, like in the unit, you know, you always want to be needed. You know, you always want to be needed. Except the quarterback, like, get in there. Mm-hmm. We need you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So I'm 21 years old, and I know how to operate this highly advanced technological, like, thermal imaging stuff.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's called a clue, combat launch unit. Where I can see everything. Yeah, I can see through buildings, got this thermal gear. So the unit was just, "Billy, like, get up here, Weatherall, get up here, we need you." And so they had really depended on me, but we would, I would just call in fire all the time to see through buildings. So I just got very used to being used and a part of the team.
Mm-hmm.
And this operation ends up being like 2 days to almost 2 weeks. Like, we didn't have enough food. We didn't bring a, you know, enough supply. And that's why we didn't bring a lot of our mop gear, which were, there was no, you know, nothing like that. That was never needed. But I mean, the time that changed everything. So there's one in particular story in Afghanistan that I'll never forget. And that's just one night. I'm on guard. I'm 20 years old. It's cold up in the mountain because you had to take a observation post high in the mountain, you know, and we didn't bring enough cold weather gear. We didn't have enough food.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm on guard, and I see this little building down in the valley, and I could see movement through it with my combat launch unit. And I call it in. They're like, "Hey, weather, I'll just watch it till morning. You know, we'll take care of it, you know, at first dawn, first light." And the morning comes. I got a 240 Bravo gunner beside me, shoots it up. They're calling some mortars, and I'm calling in all the fire. So my two buddies go down to get a situational report of, you know, how many people did we kill?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what kind of technology?
So they didn't even, like, they just, it was more of a guess. Like, we see that there's people there, but we're just going to blow it up.
No rules of engagement at all. There is none. Gosh. If you're not wearing a U.S. Army patch, you're enemy.
Okay. Did that make you feel like, did you have that feeling? Like, were you like, are you just following orders?
I mean, no. Yeah. I mean, it is just, that's what every kid dreams
it's,
about.
Yeah. Yeah. It is what it is.
And put a couple of notches on your belt. You're like, this is what it's about. This is the ultimate. This is like for the Super Bowl. Here I am at 20 years old.
Okay.
And,
right.
You know, and I'm just, man, I'm all gung ho, and I'm not like a killer, but I'm just like, man, defend the nation.
Yeah.
Defend the nation.
Exactly. That's how,
take care of the brothers beside me. But it went like, I was just looking at people, kill them. You know, I mean, everybody out here was the enemy. You know, they're just like, these people, if you don't kill them, they're going to kill you.
Sure.
Well, we shoot up this building, and two of my good buddies go down to the building to do a sit rep, and they come out, and I could just tell because I'm looking through my clue. You know, the clue's gone. I'm looking through my binos now because it just turned daylight. Now I can see through my binoculars, and I could just tell something's wrong with them. And we're calling them on the radio. We had their walkie-talkies. We're like, hey, you know, what's the report? And just their posture was down, their gun posture. And these were two of my good friends. You can, tell something was not good about this.
Yeah, yeah.
They come up the mountain and I'm like, dude, what's going on? Like, no, they're not communicating with anybody. And they're like, dude, look, we just shot, you know, just children. They're like, apparently this is where they put all their children. And, you know, you kind of like, okay, store that and put that in the back of your mind.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. And, you know, the week, you know, the 2 weeks there was just so taxing. It's just every night it was just something. Every day it was something.
But you and, were just following orders.
Yeah, absolutely.
All of you.
I was
happy
to do it. Yeah, yeah, all of us were. And one night I'm just so cold. I'm so hungry and all this stuff had happened. And I get up for guard. I get woke up. I'm tired. I'm hungry. I'm cold. And I walk, you know, knock the frost off of my watch because it's so cold up there. And I just turned 21 years old. And, you know,
happy birthday.
And I just had a mental breakdown. Yeah, I just had a mental breakdown. I'm like, you know, what have I done? Like, all my buddies went to LSU. They're sleeping around. They're eating. They're having sex. They're doing drugs. You know, like, and I'm stuck on this mountain and just nothing. Like, I'm just dead. I'm tired. I'm worn down. So we come back from Afghanistan, and we were the very first people to go to combat. Like, we were the guys. And come back, and we got our little combat infantry badge. You know, I've just turned 21. My chest is held high, but I mean, we just started getting in trouble when we get back. Like, I could just tell there were problems developing with the guys. You know, they're beating up their wives. They're getting DWIs. And, you know, their fights. We're fighting on the weekend. So the unit's like, guys, we got to do something. So they send us to Africa. And they're like, look, we got you guys a mission. You're going to Africa. Like, we're going to hide you guys for a while, you know. Because the military was very – they didn't know how to handle us, you know. In Afghanistan, we would work with the Iraq – I mean, the Northern Alliance, the Taliban. I mean, not Taliban, but the Northern Alliance, the good guys. Right. And we had a base with them, and they would chew, like, this green stuff. We call it green super dip. And we were, like, mixing it with our dip, man, and it's just like, I chew this stuff. I'm like, man, I'm a learning hack. Like, let's rock and roll. But it ended up that we're doing, like, opium the whole time there. Like, you know, we've all been on everybody. I'm talking about a whole chain of command. So we don't get drug tested. They're just kind of trying to sweep everything underneath the table.
Yeah.
And, you know, they make us disappear. They're like, we're going to send you to Africa. I went to Africa. I never fired a shot. Just a really good deployment. I worked with a lot of SEAL Team 6. We had this big tryout at Camp Lemonnier. You know, they were just, like, looking for people to volunteer. You know, you had to do tryouts. And, you know, I made that and got to work with the French Foreign Legion, went through their commando school, and had a really good time in Africa. Well, at this point in my enlistment, that's it. Like, I mean, I've done my 4 years. I'm out. And I couldn't be more happier. I'm ready to go home, go to college, and just kind of, like, just forget about all this stuff. And we come back from Africa. I'm about 2 days, literally, from getting out of the Army, and I get a phone call from the first sergeant's office. His name was First Sergeant Stout, still a good friend of mine. And he's like, Weatherall, look, we just got orders to go to Iraq. He's like, we're going to Baghdad. He's like, we just can't lose you, man. He's like, you're too much of an asset. He goes, you know, only... like 20 of us guys are getting out. He's like, I couldn't lose you, and I couldn't lose another guy.
Yeah.
And I was wild. I was young, but I was a very good soldier. And so I go to Iraq, and I mean, it is just...
What does that make you feel like, though? Like, getting stop lost like that?
Well, it feels good. You know, everybody wants to feel needed. And I guess from Afghanistan, I play such a vital part where I was good. I take pride in the things that I do. You know, I just don't want to be a good gunner. I want to be the best gunner, you know, and with that attitude too, you know, when you go on your party, it's a whole nother level. It's like a different level to me. Like, I'm just so you more going to get passed out drunk.
You more felt needed.
Yes. Yes. And I didn't know inside, like, I just called my mom immediately. I went up to the room, and I'm looking good in front of the first sergeant. I was like, yes, sir. You know, you can depend on me. And I went upstairs. I just had a breakdown. I'm just like, I don't think I can psychologically do another Afghanistan. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was already drinking a little bit more, and these guys, I mean, it was just like just trying to numb the past. You know, nobody talked about it except when we got drunk. And, and it's just, you know, you go to Afghanistan and all the close air support, and you think that you're fighting these bad guys. And as you walk on the battlefield, you start assessing, you know, who you killed. You're like, oh my gosh, man, I've killed 13 to 14 year olds. It's like all I've killed is children. You know, yeah. It's not like what the movies show it. It was, you know, these powerful